Good afternoon and a warm welcome to the ESMT Open Lecture, Uncertain Times, Perspectives for a Stable Europe. The time probably couldn't have been better, or maybe the topic couldn't have been better chosen for the time, or the time couldn't have been better for this topic. Open lectures have been offered at ESMT for about 7 years, and they're always platforms to invite distinguished speakers with a broad perspective on topics of current concern, of current interest. They are offered here at ESMT in the Staatsratsgebäude, so the former headquarters of the Supreme Governing Council of East Germany. When you came through the entrance, you saw the portal, the portal 4, that used to be part of the City Palace to be recreated at this point of time. And soon, we were just said this, soon actually this portal you will see twice on this square, once in our building, so we won't give it up, we will stick to it, we'll keep it, despite the efforts actually from the other side to actually take it away, but we fought to keep it. And then we will have it twice here, and there will be a competition on who actually has a better portal, who has a better reconstruction of the initial portal. I would say it's one of the, and I keep repeating actually on this point, it's one of the nicest ironies of history that what used to be the headquarter of socialism on German soil, so what used to be the headquarter of the Supreme Governing Council of the GDR, is now a privately funded, a privately run, and a privately organized business school that actually looks into the questions of social market economy and takes a very international perspective with professors from all around the world, students from all around the world, and thus also a strong interest in the question of how international relations evolve. Today we are very delighted, honored to welcome back Jürgen Chrobog to this open lecture. We couldn't think of a better speaker than Mr. Chrobog to discuss of where Europe stands and what types of perspectives there are. Things are fairly complex, and therefore it needs a very clear perspective to actually figure out where is the essence throughout all these complexities. And Mr. Chrobog, by all his experience, his insights, his professional work he has done, for example, as German ambassador to Washington, as state secretary in the Foreign Office, basically as our neighbor, has basically the unique ability to shed light on this and to provide structure to things that look rather very complex and maybe not so straightforward from an outside perspective. So therefore, we are extremely delighted to welcome Mr. Chrobog back to ESMT, a long-term friend of our school. I think even when the school did not even exist, you got already interested in who is actually the neighbor to the Foreign Office, and this is something we keep in very good memory. I'd also like to welcome our moderator, following the talk by Mr. Chrobog, Professor Michael Wohlgemuth, director of the think tank Open Europe Berlin, so therefore also with a strong interest in the question of where Europe is going, where Europe is heading. He used to be a research fellow, or actually used to be at the Walter Eucken Institute in Freiburg, and is a professor, an extraordinary professor at the University of Wittenherdecke, also a university that is close to my heart because this is where I studied, so therefore another link. So in that sense, I look very much forward to a very exciting, very interesting talk and discussion to which you obviously are also invited to contribute. And I'd like to thank the Tagesspiegel as our long-term media cooperation partner for supporting this event. With this, please join me very warmly in welcoming Mr. Chrobog to the stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Rochol. It's a pleasure to be here in this third time, and it was a good investment on my side to get in touch with you very early, at the very beginning of this university. I was invited by you today to talk about a wide range of issues, especially the internal and external challenges of the European Union, which it is facing after the Brexit. I will even make it a bit wider today and start with the most exciting issue at the moment, the upcoming American elections. You can't give a speech here without mentioning that. And the consequences for the European Union. Then I will talk about the developments in the Near Middle East, the main challenge we are facing. This has turned into a global threat. And then finally about the European Union after the Brexit. In 1 week, a new American president will be elected after the ugliest campaign ever. A new chapter in transatlantic relations will be opened. I'm not going to predict the outcome of the presidential elections. Months ago, I was very wrong when I almost guaranteed that Donald Trump will never be candidate of the Republican Party. I do not dare to be as specific again. I prefer to use a Bavarian saying, I still swear Trump will not be the next president, but I wouldn't take a bet. And even less today than even a week ago, where everybody was quite convinced that Hillary Clinton might win the elections. But since the announcement of the Republican director of the FBI, James Comey, to reopen the investigation into Clinton's email affair, I'm even more worried. This new development could be a game changer. I hope it won't, but it could be. It really sheds a strange light on the American system, actually, that a Republican CIA director can interfere in the election process at this very late moment. But still, Hillary Clinton is leading the polls. But as you probably know, the final outcome depends on the number of delegates in 6 swing states, especially Florida and Ohio, where the margins are increasingly narrow. We remember in 2000, Gore won the popular vote, but lost the electoral vote and hence the presidency. The outcome of this election, who will be the next US president and which party will have the majority in the Senate and the House of Republicans, will have an enormous impact on the transatlantic relations and the future stability worldwide. A victory of Trump will cause a worldwide shock and a lot of uncertainty. Putin will be pleased, and populist parties from France to the Netherlands to Germany will see it as an encouragement for themselves. Trump's campaign record gives us an impression of what we can expect from such an unpredictable president. His campaign was based on incompetence, lies, and defamation on an international scale. Mexico, the Muslims, the future of NATO, just few examples. No matter who will become president for the next 4 years, but from next year on, we'll have to deal with a country deeply divided. The American middle class is eroding. Any social cohesion is getting lost. The Republican Party might fractionize. Also, the Democratic Party is less homogeneous than it's ever been. I doubt any of the 2 candidates will be able to reunite the American society during the next 4 years. It is difficult to guess who will be the next president. To predict the future composition of the Congress is even harder. The current leadership of the Republican Party, believing that Trump is going to lose, is strongly investing money and political support to remain in control of the Congress. They are financing their people, the people they like, still in this party, to make them win. According to the latest polls, the most likely scenario is a narrow Democratic majority in the Senate and a diminished Republican majority in the House of Representatives. Whatever will be the outcome of these elections, in the next years, America will be more focusing on its domestic problems than on its relationship with Europe and the rest of the world. It will be a less reliable and more demanding partner for the European Union. This is one of the most important reasons why we need a stronger and more united European Union. We have to get our act together. Whatever the outcome of these elections, looking at the present options on the table, I believe President Obama will be missed more in Europe than in the United States. And will be mostly missed in Germany. In a way, he was a very European president in his approach to the world, which is an unforgotten speech in Cairo at the beginning of his presidency. He improved the US image worldwide, especially in the Arab world. It is unfortunate that he was not able to fulfill all of the expectations he had raised. His 8 years as president were a permanent uphill battle. The resistance to Congress against his domestic as well as foreign policy blocked most of his initiatives. The reestablishment of diplomatic relations with Cuba and the nuclear deal with Iran are only two examples. The very success of Obama's foreign policy, even they are still facing strong opposition in America, not only among Republicans, by the way. In the Middle East, Obama's efforts were unfortunately less successful. George W. Bush left a terrible mess to his successor. His war in Iraq, a disaster. Americans' post-war nation-building efforts in Iraq totally failed with serious consequences under which also Europe suffers until today. Against all warnings of experts, the then US Representative Paul Bremer dissolved the Ba'ath Party and the army. He destroyed the only structured entities in Iraq. This was the hour of the birth of the Islamic State. We all know the consequences, instability in the region, terrorism, millions of refugees trying to reach a safe haven in Europe. Since the war in Iraq, America's influence in the Arab world has steadily weakened. The United States is no longer the sole power that could be able to restore and guarantee order in the Middle East. Russia is back on the stage. The regional powers, Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Turkey, are pursuing their own interests with military means. Obama was not able to reverse this trend. He took and had to take decisions that were seen by former allies in the Arab world as a sign of weakness and withdrawal from the US, of the United States from the region. This undermined further the American leadership in this area. For example, the speedy withdrawal of American troops from Iraq and the support for a Shiite government which discriminated against the Sunni majority, the declared red line to prevent Syria from using chemical weapons, which proved to be an empty threat, the half-hearted and late support for the opposition force in Syria, the exclusion of further American military intervention, but airstrikes in Syria. All these decisions were no Obama's first choice, but the result of the opposition in the Congress and the unwillingness of the American people to remain militarily involved in the regional quagmire. What could we Europeans expect from the president of Hillary Clinton? And I still presume she will be the next president. President Obama endorsed her with the words, "I do not think there's ever been someone so qualified to hold this office." He might be right. Her experience, her predictability, her knowledge of Europe, and our European expectation are to a certain extent a guarantee that she will continue the present American foreign and security policy. If no for other reasons, this makes her our preferred candidate in Europe. But many American voters have a difficult view. For them, the choice between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump is a choice between bad and evil. Among the Democrats, many young people would have preferred and were enthusiastic about Bernie Sanders, mainly because he does not belong to the political establishment and the wealthy big shots of New York. Hillary Clinton's foreign policy record is mixed. In 2002, as a senator, she voted in favor of the congressional resolution that authorized the invasion of Iraq. Today, she sees herself as a mistake. As Secretary of State, she was less reluctant than Obama to send more troops to Afghanistan. She was co-responsible for what happened in Libya. She repeatedly called for the imposition of a no-fly zone in Syria. In an investigative report of the New York Times, one former member of the State Department was quoted saying, when the choice is between action and inaction, and you have got risk on either side, she'd rather be caught trying. She's more hawkish in her foreign policy than Obama has ever been. Now let us look into the situation in the near Middle East, or European neighborhood. In view of the proxy war between Saudi Arabia and Iran in Yemen, the situation in Libya and unstable Egypt, as well as the ongoing presence of the Islamic State, despite its last defeats, the future does not look promising. Our NATO partner, Turkey, is more interested in preventing the Kurdish state at its borders than fighting the Islamic State. Erdogan's ambition in Iraq and Syria, where he wants to be part of the liberation of Mosul and Raqqa, reflects the nostalgia of the Ottoman Empire, which raised concerns in the region. The civil war in Syria remains the most serious problem in this part of the world. Aleppo is going to fall. In order to survive, Assad needs to control the two biggest cities in Syria, Damascus and Aleppo. This is the only way to strengthen his role in future negotiations. Assad's terror against the population of Aleppo and other cities with the support of Russia is outrageous. But unfortunately, there's not much we can do as Europeans against it. Putin is taking his time. He's waiting for the next US president. Threats of sanctions do not seem to impress him. Russia is a difficult but unfortunate indispensable neighbor in Europe, especially with regard to the Ukraine. Only negotiated peace process here can be a solution. I admire the relentless efforts of Secretary of State Kerry in these endeavors, but also admire Steinmeier's and Iroh's permanent efforts to participate, to contribute to such a peace negotiating process. The relationship between Russia and the United States is becoming more hostile. Both countries are in a spiral of confrontation. The military forces in Syria are close to each other. Russia aircraft carriers are on their way, and accidental military confrontation can never totally be excluded. The establishment of a new fly zone in Syria, which was proposed also by Hillary Clinton, would increase this danger. With regard to Syria and Ukraine, Hillary Clinton is expected to be tougher on Russia than Obama, not to mention Donald Trump. She also has an open bill with Putin because of his alleged interference in the American elections. She will not be too keen to ease tensions. This means a new challenge for the European Union, which also, as we know, divides its attitude toward Russia. Russia can no longer be seen as just a regional power, as Obama had unfortunately stated some years ago. Putin proved him wrong and brought his country back on the internet stage and the regional map. He has still to settle a score with the West and especially with the United States. He considered NATO expansion as a threat. He had warned against the overturn of Saddam Hussein and Gaddafi without a plan for the future of Iraq and Libya. Today he is warning that overthrowing Assad would destroy the last structure in Syria with bloody consequences and anarchy. Unfortunately, he was right in the past. He might even be right with regard to Syria. In this power game in the Middle East, Putin's pushing the Americans ahead. The European Union will have to deal with a very self-confident Russian president in the future. And now to the European Union. Europe must have the capacity for both external and internal actions to cope with the challenges of a rapidly changing world. With the challenge of, what we see today is not very promising. The Union is preoccupied with itself instead of taking a leadership role in the internet crisis management. The issue of immigration has deeply divided the European Union member state. The decision of Mrs. Merkel to allow so many refugees to enter Germany caused hostile reaction in many European states. Obama seems to be a last friend of the world because in front of the United Nations General Assembly, he praised Angela Merkel for her humanitarian attitude. The rise of populist parties all over Europe is the driving force behind the policy of most of the European governments. These parties are warning their followers of big waves of refugees from Africa and Asia and the danger of Muslims for our Christian identity, especially in countries which have always refused to accept any refugees at all. The dream of the United Europe is fading, if it ever existed in all European countries. The European Union was supposed to be based on shared values, freedom, democracy, solidarity, and inclusion. The solidarity within the European Union is eroding. Countries like Poland and Hungary are trying to ruin the European Union. The request for renegotiation of EU treaties are an attack against the legal structures. This is a kind of rollback strategy with the aim of renationalization. The upcoming elections in Austria, in France, and later next year in Germany will further postpone all necessary efforts for a new beginning. And now the Brexit itself. Theresa May announced that in the first quarter of 2017 she will trigger Article 50 of the Lisbon Treaty and hereby start the procedure leading the UK exit of the European Union. The decision is final. The repeal of the European Communities Act, which ends European law supremacy in the United Kingdom, was a statement. To please the Brexiteers and in her party, Ms. May is going for the hard Brexit. After 2 years of negotiations, the United Kingdom will be out. But we need many more years to dissolve all treaties and the tens of thousands of regulations. In 1975, David Ennals, a member of the British Labour Parliament, warned against the country joining the European Union by stating, "You cannot unscramble the egg, it will never be an egg again." And he was very right. That describes our dilemma. It will be even more complicated to negotiate the new terms of a future relationship with the European Union. The example of CETA shows how difficult it will be to convince the remaining 27 former member states, its governments, and approximately 42 national and regional parliaments to ratify a new trade agreement. The main and most complicated issue is, as we all know, the future membership of the United Kingdom in the single domestic market, which is for its four freedoms, movement of people, capital, service, and goods. In further evidence that Prime Minister King is pursuing a hard Brexit strategy, she ordered her government's powerful immigration task force to ensure that a new regime is introduced to slash the net number of arrivals into the United Kingdom. She has also asked the task force to help cut migration numbers by making it harder for illegal immigrants to stay in the countries. And the Poles heard this message already. We are not talking about immigrants from the Middle East and Africa, but about immigrants from our European states. Poland were invited after Polish accession to the European Union to come to the United States. It was fishing for Great Britain, the government fishing for talents from Poland. Germany was very much reluctant. We said, okay, the 7 years transit period will keep us safe here on our side. But they brought the Poles to United Kingdom. Now the Poles are more independent, they have their own businesses and so on, and they became a nightmare for many people in Great Britain who are afraid of that they get access into the university system, into housing, and take away their jobs. But they don't accept the fact that these Polish people are paying taxes, paying into social security, sometimes more than the British are doing themselves. It's a shame in a certain way. European leaders have repeatedly made clear that full access to the single market is incompatible with restriction to the free movement of people. Interestingly, once again, anybody is looking now at Germany and Chancellor Merkel. She will play a key role in setting the US the future terms. Merkel has been patient with the British so far and warns against any punishment. She is now facing a strategic dilemma, either to please the British and be soft on migration, or keep the European Union of 27 together. After Ms. May ruled out any compromise with regard to the freedom of movement, the German Chancellor made her position very clear. Full accession to the European single market only on the basis of reciprocity of the four freedoms. It's a very clear message from her. It is amazing how much the British government is in denial with regard to economic and financial consequences of the Brexit. Theresa May declared that, and I quote, "The Brexit will not hurt the British economy, never mind the access to the single market. Great Britain's location is the best in the world. Everybody in the world speaks English." But when we remember that she herself warned against a Brexit and The Guardian published her papers, it's amazing how easily people in Great Britain can change their position. Everybody turned 180 degrees ago. Everybody was in favor or against the Brexit. It was really quite amazing. The only outspoken and realistic member in May's cabinet is the Chancellor of the Chequers, Philip Hammond. He predicted a worsening economic outlook and a huge budget deficit for the United Kingdom as a result of the Brexit. This did not make him very popular among his colleagues in the cabinet. The City of London gets nervous. 3 weeks ago, I was invited by some hedge funds in London to talk about Germans' views on the Brexit. People I met were not yet panicking, but all expressed deep concern about their future. Passporting, the right to trade freely in all European countries has become the main concern in all this discussion I had. Without access to financial markets in the European Union countries, the city of London would be paralyzed. And they're very much concerned about that. But there's another threat they're afraid of, the threat of being forced to move out of London. They all love London. It's a nightmare for them, especially if it goes to Frankfurt. They don't want, they always prefer London, which I understand, to Frankfurt and to work in Frankfurt. Actually, I heard from somebody who was the former mayor of Frankfurt that in Frankfurt, even the city is not too happy about this development. Too many people are concerned about rising prices, not enough apartments and so on, and they are afraid of stress, a very, very German answer to a new opportunity and a new challenge, actually. And we shall see how it will go. The current incertitude is poison for the economy. There's no planning security for the future status of companies and the workforce. As a consequence, new investment will be postponed, as you can hear from German companies already. People are just concerned about their future planning. For Germany, the Brexit has severe consequences, not only because the United Kingdom is one of our most important trading partners. We have a common understanding of free trade, budget discipline in the European Union, and the need for a stable financial system. Germany and the United Kingdom share a lot of similarities. We will miss an important liberal voice in the European Union and a like-minded country. Germany will also lose the United Kingdom as a member of the bloc and minority, which can veto majority decisions in the European Council in order not to be overruled by other European countries. It will be very difficult to change the Lisbon Treaty. It has to be done to rebalance the voting system in the European Union. And to change the Lisbon Treaty, everyone knows what it could mean and how long it will take. My last question will be now, who will lead Europe in the future? Germany has always been a reluctant leader, or as an observer once thought, a reluctant hegemon. In 2011, Poland's former foreign minister, Radoslaw Sikorski, said, with regard to problems in the Eurozone, that he was less afraid of German power, but of German inactivity. I do not think that Jaroslaw Kaczynski and the new government shares this view. But anyway, France has always been and still is our closest political partner. Both countries have learned that only together we can make progress in Europe. But France is weakened by the upcoming elections and its economic and social problems. France is more and more leaning to the southern European states who want to soften the European Stability Pact in favor of rising debts. However, and with all this in view, I'm not concerned that the European Union will fall apart in the near future. I do not foresee exit referendum by member states like Hungary and Poland, if not for any other reason than because there's financial too much in stake for these countries. Poland, I think they get 15 billion or something like that per year. It's very difficult to give that up and continue to take care of their own population. Italy seems for me to be one of the biggest problems we are facing. Renzi has linked his political future to the referendum on structural reforms. He needs to win or he might have to step down. A political takeover of the Five-Star Party under an irrational and unpredictable Grillo will cause severe problems for the rest of the European Union. I should also mention the presidential election in Austria. Hopefully this time without using German glue on the envelopes. The not improbable victory of Mr. Hofer could mean a big blow for the European Union. He intends to dissolve the Austrian parliament immediately. Early election would take place next year and might be won by Karl-Heinz Strache and his FPÖ. Strache just condemned Merkel's policy as a criminal act. The German chancellor will lose another like-minded countries. She'll be very lonely in the future, any German chancellor, however it is, but especially Mrs. Merkel in the next year and the years to come. The European Union should not be paralyzed because of Brexit. We have to look forward and tackle the challenges we are facing. It is not the time for discussion about change of institutions of the European Union. This has been the first reactions, as we remember, in Brussels after Brexit referendum took place. Such a policy would send the wrong message to the increasing number of people in Europe who are concerned about the European policy and about Brussels and the influence of this bureaucracy. On the other hand, the European Union cannot afford to stand still. we have to explore all possibilities for closer cooperation within the Lisbon Treaty. The most pressing issues are reduction of youth unemployment, increase of competitiveness, securing our outside borders and to regain control of immigration, and at the same time fight against its causes, and we need closer cooperation in our fight against terrorism. Finally, we have to develop our common foreign policy and security policy. France and Germany were almost the only active partners during the last years. Both countries tried hard and not without success to ease tension in the Ukraine. Also in the peace process in Syria, they cooperated closely. The United Kingdom, unfortunately, was almost invisible, only focused on their referendum. The outcome of the American elections and the new structures of the European Union, we need a reassessment of Germany's future foreign and security policy, because more engagement from us will be expected, if we like it or not. For the time being, the immigration of refugees seems to be under control. The closure of borders within the European Union, as unwanted as was for us, and the deal with Turkey stopped the flow of asylum takers. Despite increasing tension with the EU, Turkey is still honoring this agreement. This deal might be difficult to defend on moral grounds, but we need it, otherwise Greece will get thousands of refugees again. But who knows how long this will last? Erdogan is burning bridges behind him. He was doing now with regard to introducing the death penalty and press, freedom of press and so on, proves very much that he doesn't care anymore about Europe and about how he's seen in Europe. And the next step might even be that he gets away from this agreement. The human traffickers will find other ways. According to the United Nations Commission on Refugees, worldwide 65 million people are displaced. Millions of them see their future in Europe. Tens of thousands are continuously trying to cross the deadly Mediterranean Sea on their way. The international community, including the European Union, has to do much more to help Syria's neighboring countries, which have accepted millions of refugees, many more refugees than we have taken in the European Union. The situation in the refugee camps is deplorable. The only way to keep people in the area close to their home countries and prevent them from taking the deadly route of the Mediterranean is to improve the living conditions in the refugee camps. But here, the international community, also the European Union, is not doing enough. When we hear the United Food Service, when they complain about they have to decrease the food ration to half because they don't get the money mail, is frightening. Mrs. Merkel said some time ago that it was a big mistake to leave Italy and Greece alone for so long when they were overrun by refugees. It was really a big mistake. Hopefully this will not happen again. We hear the complaints already of Renzi and Tsipras that because of the economic problems they cannot cope with the situation and that the EU does not do to help enough. The answer can only be a European solution. The lack of solidarity among the member states is frightening. Ms. Merkel always asks for a European solution, and we know it's leading nowhere. The most urgent challenge will be how to convince the citizens of the European Union of the advantages of the European Union. It's too easy for the populists on the right and left to infiltrate even the middle class with their perils. The old narrative about peace is not working anymore. The younger generations take everything which has been achieved over the decades for granted. Surveys conducted in the United Kingdom after Brexit have shown that 75% of the young people wanted to remain in the European Union, but only 20% participated in the referendum. Another additional 10% would have changed the picture. Perhaps even more important, this is my last remark, then the question who will lead Europe is how its political leaders are able to reach out to the European citizens and explain what the European Union really means for everybody, especially for the next generation. It's a big task for universities like ESMT, and I'm still waiting for the big speech, for the important speech addressed to the European people, what's in stake. But nobody was able, not the German Chancellor, not the German President, never were in any countries to give the speech with very, very urgent, very necessary. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chrobog. I think we will now sit down here, have a short dialogue. amongst ourselves and then pretty soon open the debate to the public. That was a rather impressive summary of all the crises and problem areas that we face. A little bit depressive, perhaps, as well, but that's in the nature of things. So you sketched the uncertainties from outside Europe, the Middle East, Syria, IS, the aggressive authoritarianism from our neighbors, Russia and Turkey, and perhaps also the scariest day of the year was not yesterday, Halloween, but next Tuesday. inside the EU, we have still the euro crisis, I would say, the rising populism, the Brexit challenge, and then something that reminds us that inside and outside can no longer really be separated, right? It shows us that the refugee crisis, but also international terrorism, reminds us that Europe is not an island that we are involved in. And I think you pointed out that very well. You have such a lot of experience in your lifetime. You've been a diplomat during the Cold War, ministry spokesman during German unification, ambassador to the US. You freed hostages in the Sahara. You've been yourself taken hostage in Yemen. You've been to Pakistan and many, many other unsafe places in very uncertain times. And so perhaps I'd like to ask you a very general question. Is this the most risky and uncertain time that you have seen in your lifetime? Or, is it really that bad? Or how does that compare? Is that a new quality of risks and uncertainties that we face today?
Referred to the Cold War.
Yeah.
It was a very compared stable situation.
Right.
In comparison to our new situation. Because we had the good ones or the bad ones or the red ones and black ones, whatever, how you call them.
It was more clear cut.
It was clear cut, and nobody took chances to risk another war. And all the smaller countries worldwide were under control of one side or the other. But now, irrationality is leading, is governing the world. And this becomes very, very difficult. I always told my former boss, Mr. Genschamal, we could have been very lucky that we were playing with two balls. But now you all have to deal, or we have to deal with so many irrational and ruthless parties all over the world. It's totally out of control. It's so easy to get weapons of mass destruction, so easy to threaten the world. I think we are in a very, very difficult time of our life.
That's an interesting aspect, this Habermasian neue Unübersichtlichkeit, this is confusion situation where you cannot really say who's on what side and you cannot...
And changing really sides all the time, yeah.
Yeah, right. I've seen a poll of fund managers that found, they were asked, what is the biggest risk for financial markets? And they pointed out two things. It's the US elections. Certainly a Trump victory would be a very high and, unmanageable risk in a certain sense, and the dismantling of Europe. Would you also put these on the very top of, if you can have a kind of a spectrum of likelihood and risk, what concerns you most at the moment?
I think the in case Obama against Trump wins, it would be a disaster. And the markets have all reacted. And because he's irrational, he is not in control of things, and he has no clue about what's going on. It's even more. But it always depends on who will be his advisor or advisors.
Right.
I know a lot of people in the States from former times who are so keen to be part of the government again. They even would go back to the government, even working for Trump. Perhaps it's in a certain way a good idea, but a lot of them have names we learned to hate over the last decades. I mean, it will be very, very, and Trump obviously is not a man who likes to listen to people mm. who likes to learn. But that's not our hands. But as I said, the New York Times yesterday or the Washington Post made a study that with 90% they believe that Hillary Clinton is winning the elections. But you see, 8 days are a long time, or 7 days are a long time. Everything can come again. Yeah. And Hillary Clinton is very, very vulnerable now. Mm. And everybody believes that other things, other tapes or whatever could be published. And it's a shame in a certain way. But now they're also trying to get Trump on the agenda and again because of taxes and so on.
Right.
There are also new sources who say that he went even much further than he had said. But it's really, really a problem, but it's not in our hands. We have to wait and see. Mm. But the euro and the European Union and the single European market, that's an enormous threat for us as well, perhaps less than for the United Kingdom. But people are really worried about that. I really don't understand why Mrs. King is so keen now to go the hard way to make it.
Theresa May.
Mrs. May is not, she's like a Kenya. Mrs. May is so is going the hard way now, the hard Brexit, because her country can only suffer. But she's so much in the hands of the Brexiteers now. Because of his former remarks, he has now to prove that she's a stubborn and very clear-cut Brexiteer. But it would have been possible to take a soft way, just not to say all immigrants are not welcome anymore, but to find this rule on the social scale, not to allow them to get into the security system anymore for the couple of years at least. There were offers made in this respect already. And we might all be following the same way, but she's going the hard way. It's amazing.
Let's see how that works out when they trigger Article 50 in these 2 years. And I think many Brexiteers will realize that you know, they were full of illusions and that the economy might react well.
I'm not sure.
Just one more question before I open the floor. I think you were right to say that the US leadership has been undermined, certainly in the Middle East, but also in the rest of the world.
So
we will see a certain, perhaps also active retreat, no matter how the elections turn out next week. Now, the big question is, can Europe fill this gap in terms of foreign policy leadership? At the Bratislava summit, there was much talk about the EU's priorities when it comes to security and protection. Can the EU deliver to really foster worldwide security? Does a foreign policy even have this ability to take on more leadership worldwide?
I'm afraid the European Union cannot. Might be Germany, France, and some like-minded could do a lot.
But not the Union as such,
Not the Union as such. Mm. And with regard to Russia, for example, the Union is deeply divided how to deal with Putin. Mm. But Germany and France has done a lot already. Germany is now falling slowly, but you know about the discussion in Germany. Mm. The left party, the Green Party, and so on, they are totally opposed against any further military commitment of the German government. It's very tough, but we have to show that we feel also responsible. It might happen, but we don't have the military means like the United States.
Exactly.
Nobody will believe that we will be able to stop anybody doing what he wants to do. That's our mistake and our problem.
Yeah, definitely. So now I think we still have some 15 minutes or so for questions from you. Ladies and gentlemen, Jörg.
So you expressed or you described the lack of the, say, great European speech that you would expect from the Chancellor or the President here in Germany. What could be, maybe not only from a German perspective, but what could be the big narrative that such a speech should contain or could contain? So what could be the, say, the grand unifying themes that we should keep in mind when we think of Europe? So something that would inspire people to say, this is really what is worth fighting for, morally.
I think in the speech you have to repeat what has been achieved over the last decades and show people how they were profiting from everything, free traveling in Europe and this general freedom within Europe. And also show them a perspective, explain to them what Brussels is able to do in the future, what we are doing, going to do in our national capacities. And take away the concern about Russia, about Brussels, about the European institutions, and explain what's in stake for the future generation. Also, if we are not combine our forces, our strengths, and we see everything is now eroding everywhere. Mm. That's a terrible danger also for the next generations. We have to get together, but why? Why are we doing what we have done in the past? To explain that, I think people did not understand really. They didn't want to understand, but many of them did not understand why things were done. Refugee policy, why we have spent so much money on Greece, for example. What it mean when we stop doing that? I think that must be the narrative.
Mm. A tough job to communicate that. I now have three gentlemen clustered here in the second row. Perhaps we take them together, and then we, or you try to answer these questions, please.
Thank you very much. I'm a former businessman and have been member of the European Parliament for 10 years. I have a couple of comments on Brexit and then one question. The UK has been a very positive partner of Germany very often when it came to voting, etc. But it has also been a very difficult partner for the EU in total. And what we need most right now in the EU, a common defense and security policy, has always been sabotaged by the UK. So therefore, and I come to the question now, I think that the Brexit is in a way, if we do it well, also a chance for the EU27 to really come to join forces, develop a common strategy when it comes to defense and security, develop a common also industrial policy when it comes to defense industries, things that have been impossible because the UK flatly refused to participate. And let me add another thing. Döpfner, the CEO of Axel Springer, talked about Brexit a few weeks ago at a financial at a meeting in London organized by the Financial Times, and he played devil's advocate and said he wouldn't rule out that at the end the UK will be the winner of Brexit because it will practice the free market economy rightly. Whereas, and it will be effective also because it will eliminate too much regulation, bureaucracy, etc. And he added, the rest of Europe will increasingly become a transfer unit.
Mm. Thank you. Would you pass the microphone to Graf Strachwitz right
there? It's very last remark. It's a very important one. We do not want to become a transfer union. We are pushed more and more by France and other countries to go this way. Mm. But your first question, I totally agree. I agree. Great Britain was always a very important partner for us. Well, I mentioned all these issues already, but they were always very difficult for the European Union. I have no doubt about that. And concerning a joint military and security policy was almost impossible. When Juncker made a suggestion a couple of weeks ago, they immediately went public, said the Europeans want to block NATO and want to build up their own capabilities, which was totally nonsense, because we only talked about a closer coordination. I mean, it's totally nonsense. But on the other side, I mean, we need a European Union without the United Kingdom. It's very difficult to imagine how things could be. And what was your last second question about?
Well, it was different, you know, whether or not the UK will take advantage by...
Okay. I don't agree with what you said or the world said that... What was said there. I don't think that we'd be better off. Even the Americans toward the British, if you want a new trade deal with the United States, you have to line up. It will take years and years and years, years of uncertainty for the British economy, and all export-oriented companies in Great Britain. We have problems, and I think it will be a big shock for the British economy, which will be coming up. I personally believe the disadvantages for Great Britain are more problematic than for the European Union. But we also will suffer. Many, many German companies are working and producing, manufacturing in the United Kingdom. And what will be the status? Could get people from foreign countries, specialists from foreign countries? Do they only have to rely on British people? I mean, there's a lot at stake, and how can they export their products? How can BMW export their cars to the European market? How can Rolls-Royce sell cars in the European market anymore? It's a German company, but produced in the United Kingdom. There's a lot at stake now. Nobody knows how it will end. I'm not very much in agreement with you that the Brexiteers will really try to reverse it, or will one day reverse it, because the party is more or less in the hands of Brexiteers, but the parliament is more still dominated by Remainers.
That's right.
Therefore, she does not dare to ask the government, the party now, which would be a very, very democratic view, by the way, to discuss even the referendum. I mean, it's a very strange policy.
And the big challenge would be how to avoid mutual self-mutilation, right?
Yeah.
That the UK economy is hurt, and the German and the European ones as well. This would be a terrible disaster, but it looks like this is, at least now before the negotiations, these are the red lines. And then we have to see how these... How the game unfolds. Krafft-Strachwitz, perhaps also on that side.
Okay. Thank you. You made it very clear in your presentation that Europe has to get its act together. And then a little later you said that, in fact, the European Union was not really able to act on the world scene, but it was the individual countries, France and Germany and perhaps one or two others. Does this mean that we have to think about new instruments, that we have to leave the European Union to do what it's been doing, but that to get our act together, we actually have to sort of start thinking afresh and devise some totally new way of getting together?
Not new instruments, not new treaties, but we have indeed think about the future of the European Union in the perspective of membership groups. I think we cannot go ahead under these conditions. Take the Eastern European partners, Poland, Czech Republic, and Hungary. They will not go along with us, even not in our foreign policy towards Russia. And the Balkan states, the Baltic states, are trying to draw us into their security ambience. It will be very difficult. We need a core group of the European Union. But it's become smaller and smaller. It's Germany, might be half France, but it must be France. Without France, it's not possible. Austria, you never know what will happen. Italy, the founding father of the European Union, could go down the drain.
Yeah.
I mean, then we have a two-party or two-country European Union. That's not possible. The Dutch have a lot of problems with their right-wing people, and they are always leaning very much towards United Kingdom. It will be very, very difficult. There will be only a very small core of groups, but they shouldn't be hindered to go ahead and do what has to be done among their own framework.
Right.
I agree with you.
And then there was the gentleman right next.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
my question is, do you think that the remaining core of the European Union will be able to revise their Russia policy? I'm saying this in light of the recent statements by President Putin in Sochi at the Valdai Club, where he called for a Marshall Plan of the Middle East and the Syria region, which was enthusiastically received. There have been similar calls for a Marshall Plan of the region by the German Development Minister, Müller, and also by, I think, Schäuble, when he was in Davos and also on television shows. Might that be a common ground for a new East-West policy, which is desperately needed, And my second question is, you have in your very enjoyable presentation, but not touched on the new role of rising China, which is not seen very negatively in many, many parts, despite now certain, you know, disambiguities. But China is investing heavily, for example, in the China-Pakistan economic corridor, but also I think they're building infrastructure for 5 million Egyptians right now, or they have plans to do that. This reaches also into Europe, not only into southern and eastern Europe, but also into Germany. There is a perspective because the New Silk Road, as it is called, is also a universal program where European nations can join freely. Do you think that is also part of a new perspective? Thank you.
If we talk about the future of the European Union and it is and our engagement in the Middle East, it's quite cynical to say, but Russia is now destroying Syria more or less with own military aircraft, with all aircraft, with their only planes, and together with Assad. They destroy everything first, and then they ask for a Marshall plan for this area. We need it at the very end. We have to do a lot. It will cost a lot of money just to rebuild the structures for people to survive and to remain in the Middle East. But this demand of side of Russia, it's premature. It's not feasible until we end this war with a peace treaty. Hopefully one day it might happen. And until we get also Turkey and Saudi Arabia and Iran under control to stop their terrible war, Saudi Arabia and Iran against Yemen, for example. This is also a country that is totally distracted now. And this very beautiful city of Aden, will be of Sana'a especially, will be destroyed also. So much is hurt, so much is damaged now, that it's very, very difficult to find a solution or talk about a solution after this bloody war has ended. I think it will take a long time. And we have to unite our forces, but not only the European Union, but worldwide, to do whatever is possible. It's in our own interest, by the way. But concerning China, it's very far away now of my thinking, and I'm not an expert there, but China is playing a more important role also in Africa. Mm. And it is what they are doing there, they don't care about democracy or dictatorships, about bloodshed and whatever. They go their way, they want raw materials, and they invest in countries. Which will many people already. When I was in Namibia, for example, they explained to me how many Chinese had come to rebuild to build the infrastructure there. But they don't do it with workforce of Namibia, they do it by bringing their own people. Thousands of people, and these Chinese stay there at the very end. They're located in Namibia, and that happens in many countries. I mean, this kind of colonization in a way which we must be very afraid about as well.
Thank you very much. I think these two gentlemen, but then we have to close that that list.
My name is Mark. I am teaching mechanical engineering at the Technical University of Berlin. Let me refer back to the Brexit. I'm amazed to what extent the Brexit has generated irritation and confusion in the European Commission, as well as in many German political circles and party circles, viewing it the fact that an exit of any of the 28 states was legally permitted according to the European treaties. Sure. Thus, the Commission, at least, with 50,000 highly and tax-free paid employees, should since long has made a worst-case scenario not to be trapped in the fact when it happens. Thank you.
Thank you. And the gentleman right behind you.
You are a scientist. You might be right. You are right. But there was no plan B, neither in the United Kingdom, neither in the European Union. Juncker went to bed the night before and wanted to be asked to be wake, to ask people to wake him up in case something happened. And everybody was so convinced this would not happen. Even the British even Farage, even Johnson,
Boris,
and Theresa May, nobody believed that would happen. They were shocked by themselves. Nobody had plan B for the aftermath. Nobody has plan B about Trump, by the way. Everybody believes and that he might not win, hopes he might not win. And here, this our wishful thing is father of the outcome at the very end, perhaps. But it's very difficult to make plan Bs and to have plan Bs because they're so complicated and not very much liked.
Right. And now the final question, please.
Put them both together.
First question on Brexit. I'd like to have, thank you very much for your concise analysis, but I'd like to have some concrete policy recommendations from you now. First on Brexit. Assuming the British don't compromise on immigration, what kind of deal would you offer them? Would you be willing to compromise on access to the single market for economic reasons, maybe take away the passporting rights, demand some payments into the budget? Or would you recommend a hard line, refusing all access to the single market, but incurring much, much higher economic costs? Second question on Russia. You didn't mention Crimea. You lauded very much the very indeed laudable efforts by Steinmeier and Kerry on the diplomatic front. But what would be your recommendation to liberate Crimea? I mean, Crimea was the very first hostile takeover of foreign territory for a very, very long time in Europe. Do you think diplomatic efforts would be sufficient? For sure, we don't want any military option, but would you, for example, recommend stricter sanctions also? Thank you.
All right, so that was the final question, a rather big one.
Yeah. Crimea, to start with that. Indeed, this was a breach of international law, nobody doubt that. But do you think, it's my question now to you, that we will make our relationship to Russia depend on the fact that they might give up the Crimea? Russia will never give Crimea up, because that is seen in Russia as a part of their own identity. And I don't see anybody in the world who will finally say, okay, our further relations with Russia will depend on this very issue. Ukraine, and east of Ukraine, yes. We need the Russians to give way, to be more cooperative. We need to get away with this problem in eastern Ukraine. But Crimea, I would never mention in this context. This might be cynical, and because it has its own history, and I don't think that Crimea will ever go back to Ukraine. It's very, very, very clear. And how tough might we be on the Brexit in as far as immigration is concerned? I mean, the statements are very clear of even Mrs. Merkel. She always offered a way out for Ms. May, to take a soft stand, to find a compromise, to more talk about the conditions of immigrants from the European Union instead of saying they have to get out or they are not welcome anymore. And this has hardened our situation. That made it more difficult for us. But if you look at Poland, for example, Polish people are killed already. There's xenophobia going on in the United Kingdom. They will never accept a deal with Great Britain if they are not willing to let Polish people stay and remain in the United Kingdom or let people come. I think that's a very, very important issue. And if it's not going to happen, then after years or 1 year longer, perhaps, the Brits will out of the European Union and they have to renegotiate everything from scratch on, which will take many, many years. It will have enormous consequences also for the German economy, for the European economy, but we have to go through it. And I think that the German economy in a certain way will not suffer as much. We will lose markets, but not as much as the United Kingdom and British economy.
Well, on that happy note, I think we will have to end this debate. And again, thank you so much, Mr. Chrobog, for your very valuable insights in so many complex issues. Thanks a lot for being here and sharing your insights. Thank you all for coming. And see you around.
Thank you.